Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah al-Ladhi al-Azim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi tayyibina tahirin. Allahumma akhrijni min dhulumat al-wahn wa akrimni bi nur al-fahm. Allahumma aftah alayna abwaab rahmatik wa anshur alayna khazain ulumik bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. We have a remaining from the discussion about al-Ishtiraq wa al-Taratuf, and then we go to the ninth point. We said that whenever you use a term in a metaphorical sense, you need to have an evidence. For example, you say ra'aytu asadan yarmi. I saw a lion who was shooting. So this means that then this was not an animal. Lion here is used in a metaphorical sense. Yarmi, because lion, the real lion, cannot shoot. Or ra'aytu asadan fil hammam. I saw a lion in the bath. Real lion doesn't come to the bath. Okay? So, this evidence, whether it be yarmi or fil hammam, takes our attention from the real technical, real literal meaning to the metaphorical meaning. It is called al-Qarīnah al-Ṣārifah. Sarif. Sarf means it diverts. Yeah? It diverts your mind from al-Ma'na al-Ḥaqīqī to al-Ma'na al-Majāzī. Is it clear? And if this metaphorical meaning can have different options, the same Qarīnah identifies which metaphorical meaning is meant here. So it is sarifa, and at the same time it is mu'ayyana. Mu'ayyana means it defines, it specifies which meaning. Sometimes you have a term which has more than one meaning, like ayn. Again, here you need evidence to identify which meaning is meant. Is this ayn al-baqiya? Is it ayn al-jariya? Is it the ayn which is silver? Is it ayn which is gold? So you need, again, evidence. But this evidence, it is not called sarifa. Sarifa is for what? For the evidence which is used for metaphorical sense. Because sarifa means diverts. So if the evidence was not there, your mind was going to the real meaning. But for a term which has different meanings, our mind does not go anywhere. Yeah, because it gets stuck. You don't need to divert your mind. You need to specify the meaning so that your mind goes somewhere, otherwise gets stuck. Is it clear?
Yes.
So if you look at the text, إِنَّ فَحْمَ الْمَعْنَى الْمَجَازِي بِحَاجَةٍ إِلَىٰ قَرِينَةٍ. Truly understanding metaphorical meaning needs evidence. كَقَوْلِكَ, like you're saying, yarmi. Yarmi means what? He's shooting. Ramya. أَوْ فِي الْحَمَّامِ, in the bath. فِي رَأَيْتُ أَسَدًا يَرْمِي, or رَأَيْتُ أَسَدًا فِي الْحَمَّامِ. You can say, I saw a lion who was shooting, or I saw a lion in the public bath. Yes. This means that it's used in its metaphorical sense. So we need evidence here. Kama anna ta'yin al-ma'na al-murad min bayn al-ma'ani al-mut'addida lil-lafz al-mushtarak yahtaj ila qarina. Similarly, in the same way that defining and specifying what meaning is meant among different meanings which are possible for lafz mushtarak, something which has more than one meaning, again, it needs evidence. But this evidence is different from that evidence. The first evidence, which is to take us to ma'na al-majazi, is qarīnah al-ṣārifah, and mu'ayyana, of course, it also identifies some. But the second one is not ṣārifah. كما أن تعيين المعنى المراد من بين المعاني المتعددة لللفظ المشترك يحتاج إلى قرينة كقولنا باكية أو جارية. To specify which meaning is meant out of different meanings of a term which has more than one meaning needs evidence. For example, you say عين, but then after عين you say باكية. Ayn which cries, so it's I. Or Ayn which flows, it's a spring. Lakin. So there is something common. Both of them need evidence. Lakin. But Qarīnatul Majaz, Qarīnatun Ṣārifatun wa Mu'ayyinatun. The evidence which is used for metaphorical sense, it's both Ṣārifah and mu'ayyana. Sarafa means diverts mind to the metaphorical meaning, and mu'ayyana means specifies which meaning is meant. Wa qarīnatu al-lafz al-mushtarak qarīnatun mu'ayyanatun faqat. But the evidence which is used for specifying which meaning is meant for something which has more than one real meaning is only mu'ayyana. It's not sarifa. Why it's not sarifa? Because your mind doesn't go to any of those meanings. They are equal. Yeah? It's not like majazi and haqiqi. In the case of majazi and haqiqi, if you don't bring any evidence, mind automatically goes to what? Al-ma'na al-haqiqi. But in the case of mushtarak, the mind stops, looks for an evidence to find out whether it is meant in bakiya or jariya, and so on and so forth. Yes.
Shema ol sarifa is also mu'ayyana.
Yes, sarifa and mu'ayyana, but the other one is only mu'ayyana. Yeah, you know it says. قرينة صارفة معينة والقرينة اللفظ المشترك قرينة معينة فقط.
Which is then in Jariya or in Bashiya. That's the ta'yin, isn't it?
Yes, only ta'yin. والأولى آية المجازية دون الثانية. The first evidence that is صارفة is the sign of مجازية, being متفرقة. But the second evidence is not sign of majaziyya, because they are all haqiqi. Ayn, in its true sense, can be jariya. In its true sense, can be bakiya. It's not majaz. Is it clear? Okay. This was the easy part of the discussion today. This was very easy. Okay? Now, we go to a discussion which is very difficult. But if you really understand what is the issue, inshallah, would be easy. Otherwise, this is one of the very controversial and difficult issues. So, The question is this. If we have a mushtarak, and we mean mushtarak al-lafdi, yeah? Something which has different meanings. Please pay attention to the question. We have a term which has different true meanings, real meanings, like ayn. Okay? It can be used in different meanings, up to 70 meanings. They are all haqiqi. Okay. Is it possible that in the same sentence we mention this term and we mean by it more than one of those meanings independently? Did you get the question? We use that term in one sentence and we mean by it more than one of those meanings independently. Independently is very important because, for example, if you mean something which is common, for example, you say Ayn and you mean what is called Ayn, whatever is called Ayn can be Jariya, can be Baqiya. No, no. To say one sentence and at the same time you mean once Jariya, another time Baqiya. But in the same sentence at the same time, okay? It means instead of making two statements, you made one statement, but you keep changing the meaning. Many people said this is impossible. Because you can mean only one. Some people have said it is possible, but only in negative sentences. In salbiyas, when there is negative sentence. Some people have said it is not possible when it is used singular, but if it is dual or plural, it can be used. Ayatollah Subhani doesn't go that much into details, and he says the best reason for saying that this is possible, it's what we said before. أَدَلُّ دَلِيلًا عَلَىٰ أَمْكَانِ الشَّيْءٍ وُقُوعُهُ. Yeah? The best reason to show that something is possible is the fact that it has happened. Can't something impossible happen? So if you can show that this has really happened, then that's enough. You don't need to bother about bringing arguments. He says there are many cases that such usage has been mentioned. And as an example, he mentions a poem about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he says in this poem, the term Ayn is used once, but the poet means by Ayn three things independently at the same time. As if he has repeated. Let me read for you the text up to here, then I translate the poem. Al-amru tasi' isti'malu al-mushtarak fi akthara min ma'na. Usage of a term which is equivocal, or a term which has many meanings, in more than one meaning. Two, three, four. إِذَا ثَبَتَ وُجُودُ اللَّفْظِ الْمُشْتَرَكِ. If it is established that we have lafz mushtarak. You remember some people said we don't have mushtarak because it is against the wisdom. But we said no, we have. If it is established that we have such terms, يَقَعُ الْكَلَامِ هِنَ إِذٍ, then another thing happens, another discussion. في جواز استعماله في أكثر من معنى واحد في استعمال واحد. In one usage, in one sentence, you use it in more than one meaning, more than one sense. بمعنى, in the sense that all those meanings, two meanings, كل من المعنيين or كل من المعاني, it can be more than two. مرادا باستغلال, everyone is meant independently. كما إذا قال اشتريت العين, someone says I purchased عين, and he means الذهب والفضة. So instead of saying I purchased عينا, which is ذهب, and عينا, which is فضة, he says just عينا, one عين, but he means once فضة, once ذهب at the same time. فخرج ما إذا استعمله في معنى جامع صادق على كلا المعنيين. We said it has to be مستقل, independent. So if it is used in a more comprehensive meaning, which can be applied to both of them, that is not, you know, something that we discuss. That is out of question. For example, if he says اشتريتُ عينًا, and he means what is called عين, whatever is given the name of عين. Okay, this is مشترك معنوي, then it's not مشترك لفظي. Yeah, it has different instances, not different meanings. والمفروض أن الذهب والفضة داخلان تحت هذا العنوان. If you say whatever is called عين, so silver is included, gold is included, this is not really اشتراك لفظي. So إذا علمت ذلك فعلم أنه اختلف في جواز استعمال اللفظ في أكثر من معنى واحد على أقوال أربعة. If you understood this, please be informed that there has been disagreement about the permissibility or possibility of using one term in more than one meaning. There are four opinions. Okay? There are four opinions. Al-Jawaz mutlaqa. Some said it's always okay. Some people, al-man mutlaqa, always impossible. Some people have tried to make distinction, tafsir, بين المفرد وغيره. They said, if it is used in a singular way, it's not possible. But if it is not singular, it's dual or plural, it's possible. Because when it is dual or plural, it means that as if you have few ayn. Yeah, for example, aynayn. Some people said at tafsil bayn al ithbat wa nafiyah. They said no, we distinguish between affirmative sentences and negative sentences. If it is negative, for example, if he says I didn't buy aynan, means neither silver nor gold. But if he says I bought aynan, it doesn't mean both. وَالْحَقُّ جَوَازُهُ مُطْلَقًا. Ayatullah Subhani says, but the right opinion, the correct answer is that it is always possible. What does it mean, mutlaqa? Mutlaqa. You have to understand mutlaqa by referring to those views which distinguishes between two types. So mutlaqa is opposite to the third and the fourth view. Means it doesn't need to be dual or plural. It doesn't need to be negative. Mutlaqa. In all cases, it can be used. وَأَدَلُّ دَلِيلًا عَلَىٰ إِمْكَانِهِ وُقُوعُهُ. The best reason, the best proof for possibility of this type of usage, it's occurrence. It has happened. وَيَجِدُ الْمُتَتَبِّعُ فِي كَلَمَاتِ الْأُدَبَىٰ نَمَاذِجَ مِنْ هَذَا النَّوْعِ مِنَ الْإِسْتِعْمَالِ. The one who does tatabbu'. Tatabbu', what does it mean? Search. If you search and look for different, you know, texts, you find in the words of the Udaba. What does Udaba mean? Udaba means the people who are masters in Arabic literature, or, you know, any like literature, adib, very literate, very eloquent, like poets. You find, if someone does research, he finds in the words of masters of language, namazaj, examples. Namazaj, examples of this type of usage. يقول الشاعر في مدح النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. The poet says in praising Prophet. It's madh. No madh? Praising. المرتمى في الدجى والمبتلى بعمى والمشتكي ظمى وَالْمُبْتَغِي دَيْنَا. Those who are put or thrown in darkness. Duja means darkness. If you are in darkness, those who are suffering from blindness, those who complain about thirst, and those who are in debt to someone, Dain, you know, he has debt to pay. So he mentions four types of people. Those who are in darkness, they need light. Those who are blind, they need eye. Those who are thirsty, they need water. And those who are in debt, they need money.
In debt, or they are chasing the debt?
No, no, means someone is after them.
Okay,
all these types of people, يَأْتُونَ صَدَّتَهُ مِنْ كُلِّ نَاحِيَةٍ. From every direction, they come to his door. وَيَسْتَفِيدُونَ مِنْ نَعْمَائِهِ عَيْنًا. And they benefit from his blessings. Ayn. Now, what is the meaning of Ayn? Ayn, for the people who are in darkness, is Shams. One of the meaning of Ayn is Shams, sun. Those who are blind is Basra. The same thing which we said, Bakia, Basra. Something by which you can see, eye. For those who are thirsty, is flowing water. Is a spring. For those who are in debt, it is gold. Yeah? So they all go to Rasulullah and they want Ayna. فاستعمل الشاعر لفظ العين في الشمس والباصرة والماء الجاري والذهب. So he has used the term Ayn in this sentence at the same time in four senses: sun, eye, spring, gold. حَيْثُ أَنَّ الْمُرْتَمِي فِي الدُّجَى. The one who is in darkness, what is he looking for? Shams. He is looking for light which is in shams, in sun. The one who suffers from blindness looks for eye. The one who is thirsty, al-insanu dham'an yuridu al-ma, he wants water. Al-mustadin yatlubu dhahab. The one who is in debt wants gold. So then he doesn't go further. He says, you know, this example and other examples are enough to prove that it is possible. Also, but actually, this can be questioned because this is not a true usage. It's a metaphorical usage. In poem, you know, sometimes you stretch the language. You know, you can say many things in poem that you cannot say it in normal speech.
Ideally be not from poems, because poems, they bend the rules of language.
Yes.
So it should be like a practical example.
Not in poem or anything which is, you know, poetic or metaphorical. Therefore, some people who don't agree, they question this type of examples. Yes.
We classify this as a balagha, different meanings for the same.
Yeah, actually, balagha can be sometimes by using man al-majazi. And you know, it is said that a'zabu shi'r is akzabuhu. A'zabu shi'r akzabuhu. What does it mean? The sweetest poem is the one which involves more lying. Because in poem, you know, you exaggerate, you know, say things that are not meant in the real sense, yeah? Unless it's a special poem. Many poets exaggerate or, for example, use metaphorical sense, even for good reasons. And there are poets who, you know, try to deceive people. There are poets that are criticized. الشُعَرَى وَيَتَّبِعُهُمُ الْغَاوُونَ. Okay, so, because there were some poets who used to use this technique in order just to gain money or popularity, or, you know, they were employed by the people who had power, you know, so, because there's a power in poem. You cannot underestimate the power of poem. Sometimes, maybe 1 hour of lecture may not have the same impact that one couplet of poem has. Poem is very powerful. But it can be involving metaphorical usage, it can be exaggeration, it can be stretching language. So some people say no, this is something that is not a good proof. Yes. Yaqeen means certainty. An instance of certainty can be death. You know, like it's musta'malun fi, but it's not necessarily meaning of it.
Yeah. Yes. I wanted to ask you if this is correct usage of the word. Ana ghusl al-ayni min ma' al-ayni. Is it correct usage? I'm washing my eyes with the water of the spring. The same
with the water of the spring
has been used as an eye, and it's a spring.
Yeah, that's not a problem. It's a because you have used two times the term ayn in 2 minutes. Yes.
Shekhan, do we have any other, because you mentioned poetry might not be a great proof. Do we have any
other examples from speech or from Quran or Hadith or non-poetry?
I personally believe this is not possible. And any example you bring, then I will question it. Because I think it's not possible to use one term in two senses independently as a ma'na al-mutabiqi, as if this is the complete meaning. If you add them and say it is used in both of them, this is majaz. If you say it's alternative, you know, only used, again, it's not a problem. But you say, at the same time, both of them are meant, it's not possible. Yes.
Sheikh, there is a hadith about the Quran that it has meaning which has different layers.
That's another issue.
Layers, you know.
So they are not at the same level. So, al-ma'na al-lafzi or zahiri is meant, then there is a deeper layer, but not independently. They are built upon each other. This is the problem with this, is that each of them is independent, as if the term is repeated. How can term be said only once, but you mean different meanings independently? I have a problem with this.
Shekhna, let's assume that someone said this, what the poem said.
Yeah.
In a way which is not poetry, just as a normal sentence. And said the same meaning. And in the end he said, I know. Would that not be proof? Because it's not poetry, but it's the same thing pretty much.
So it's majaz. It's not haqiqat.
Why is it majaz?
Because ayn cannot be four. Ayn is mufrad. It cannot be four things. Even it cannot be four instances of the same meaning, let alone to be four different meanings.
So if four people come and they request these four different things of you, and you go say, go to him and take ayn, can you not use that ayn to mean all four of them at the same time, independently?
So you have used then ayn in a more general meaning, in man al-jama. Everyone asks for ayn, means what is called ayn. If you say what is called ayn, then it is mushtarak al-ma'navi, not mushtarak al-lafzi. Okay, but I am happy if you agree with Ayatollah Subhan, that's not a problem. Okay. Tenth point. Al-Ḥaqīqah al-Shar'iyya. This is not as difficult as the previous one, and not as easy as the first point. So in between. Al-Ḥaqīqah al-Shar'iyya. If you listen carefully, inshallah, then it will be easy. You know, Islam has introduced many concepts, but for these new concepts, not necessarily new terms were coined. The same terms which were used before Islam, with some evidence, with some qarīnah, were used in the new meanings. For example, salat, even in the time of pre-Islam era, they used to have the term salat. Yeah, salla, yusalli, salat, they had this term. But they meant dua, calling, to call. Islam used it in a new meaning, you know, saying your prayer. Or, for example, siyam meant amsak, to avoid doing something, very general. But then Islam used it in the sense of not eating, not drinking, you know, fasting. Or zakat, for example, means purity or growth, but we use it for alms, giving alms. Okay? So, these terms have an old meaning and they have a new meaning. In the beginning, whenever Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam or Muslims wanted to use this, for example, term of salat or zakat or fasting and mean Islamic concept, a religious concept, Shari concept, in the beginning they had to mention an evidence so that people realize that it is not used in its literal sense. Yeah? For sure, in the time of Imam Baqir, Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, or maybe even shortly before that, these new meanings were established. There was no need to bring evidence. Now the question is, when these new meanings were established? Certainly not after Imam Baqir or Sadiq. By the time of Imam Baqir or Sadiq, they were established. What about before? And if you say they were established in the time of Rasulullah himself, was it with waz'a ta'ayini or ta'ayuni? For example, did Rasulullah once in a meeting said to Muslims that from now on, whenever we say salat, we mean this? Whenever we say song, we mean this? Or it was by frequent usage of the term in new meanings that it got this meaning? There was no need to formally announce that from today we use it in this meaning. They kept using and then it got the new meaning. Some people say we don't have any report that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam actually designated these terms for the new meaning. So al-waz'u ta'ayini has not been reported. Al-waz'u ta'ayyuni means by frequent usage, they say Rasulullah just lived 23 years. So this was not enough. But some people say, no, it's enough. You know, even 1 year can be enough because many times they had to say prayer. Yeah, every time, at least 5 times. So you don't need 100 years. Even maybe a few weeks is enough. If you keep, you know, saying salat, salat, hayya ala salat, hayya ala salat, it's established. Anyway, there is a discussion here. You may say, what is the benefit of discussion? The benefit of this discussion is that if a term is used in the Quran, or for example, in a prophetic hadith, and you don't know whether it's used in its literal, original sense or in its religious sense, in ma'na shar'i. If you don't believe in haqiqat al-shar'iyya, if you don't believe that the religious meaning was established at that time, so you have to interpret it according to original meaning. Okay? For example, if it is said, sallu, then you say it means odu. But if you say al-haqiqat al-shar'iyya was established, then you have to use it in the religious sense. Ayatollah Subhani says that, to be honest, this is not a very important discussion. A scholarly discussion, but practically it has not that much benefit. Why? Because we don't have, almost maybe we can say, we don't have any case in the Quran or Hadith that we doubt whether it is used in the meaning of salat or dua, or the meaning of fasting or just avoiding. They are all clear. There are lots of, you know, evidence that we don't have any doubt. So he says there is no need for spending lots of time on this discussion. But of course you have to know haqiqat al-shar'i, but no need to discuss a lot. So now, please look at the text. Because for us, understanding text is very important. Okay, I can just tell you and you refer to the English or, you know, techno, but I want you to be able to understand the text and analyze the text. Al-amru al-ashir al-haqīqatu al-shar'iyyah. This is our last discussion for today. Al-amru al-ashir is enough for today. Zahaba aksaru al-usuliyyin. What does it mean, usuliyyin? It's ulama al-usul. Yeah, the experts of usul al-fiqh. Usuliyyin doesn't mean fundamentalist. Because nowadays, you know, sometimes usuli means fundamentalist. But he means ulama al-usul. Majority, most of ulama al-usul, they are of the opinion that the terms which are used for ibadat, what is ibadat? Acts of worship. كَالصَّلَاةِ وَالصَّوْمِ وَالزَّكَاةِ وَالْحَجِّ كَانَتْ عِنْدَ الْعَرَبْ قَبْلَ الْإِسْلَامِ مُسْتَعْمَلَةً فِي مَعَانِيهَا اللُّغَوِيَّةِ عَلَى وَجْهِ الْحَقِيقَةِ. They were used among the Arabs before Islam in its in their true meanings, their literal meaning, in a haqiqat way, true usage, like Salat for dua, Som for imsak, Zakat for namuv. Namuv means growth. Hajj for qasd. وَهَذَا مَا يُعَبَّرُ عَنْهُ بِالْحَقِيقَةِ اللُّغَوِيَّةِ. So there was a real meaning which was lughavi, means based on the language. This was not religious. This has nothing to do with Islam. It was before Islam. Ila means ذَهَبَ أَكْثَرُ الْأُسُولِيِّينَ. Ila, the second thing that the majority of ulama al-usul have accepted is that these terms in the time of Imam Baqir and Imam Sadiq, Asr al-Sadiqain, Al-Baqir alayhi salam, was-Sadiq, when you do taghlib. Have you heard taghlib? Means you use the term for one of them, for both. You have to say, for example, Hassan and Hussein, you say Hassanin. Ash-Shams wal-Qamar, you say Qamarin. Baqir wal-Sadiq, you say Sadiqin. Okay? So, fi asr al-Sadiqain wa qablahuma biqalil. In the time of Imam Baqir and Sadiq, and a little bit before Imam Baqir, again, everyone accepts that by that time, certainly, they are established in the religious sense. كانت ظاهرة في المعان الشرعية الخاصة. Their meaning became these religious meanings. بحيث كلما أطلقت الصلاة والصوم والزكاة تتبادر منها معانيها الشرعية. So now you have a new معنى الحقيقي. Yeah? Which is شرعي. So you had a معنى حقيقي which was لغوي, and now you have معنى الحقيقي which is شرعي. Okay. So these two sides of the spectrum are okay. Before Islam, there was no حقيقت شرعي, it was لغوي. Shortly before Imam Baqir al-Sadiq, definitely by that time we have haqiqat al-shar'i. Haqiqat al-shar'i, not majaz, haqiqat al-shar'i. Means you don't need evidence. You could use it very easily and mean say prayer, fasting, and so on. The question is this period between. When did the shift happen? When these meanings became haqiqi? Was it in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam or not? And if it was in the time of Rasulullah, was it ta'ini or ta'ayyuni? Did you get the question? Innama al-ikhtilaf, the only controversy, disagreement is fi annahu kayfa sarat hadhihi al-alfaz haqiqatan fil ma'an al-shar'iyya. How did they become uh, true in these meanings? Means how did they got these true meanings? They possess these true meanings. في عصر الصادقين أو قبلهما بقليل. Before Imam Sadiq and Imam Baqir, or in their time, how they got these meanings? There are two opinions. ثبوت الحقيقة الشرعية في عصر النبوة. Some say no. In the time of Prophet himself, everything was established. Some say ثبوت الحقيقة الشرعية بعد عصر النبوة. They say no. The Prophet didn't designate these terms, and the time was not enough for وضع تعيني. After Rasulullah, they were gradually established. أما الأول. Those who say in the time of the Prophet they were established, فحاصله, you know, the core of the argument is this: أن تلك الألفاظ نقلت في عصر النبي من معانيها اللغوية إلى معانيها الشرعية. They say these terms نقلت. Remember last session I said منقول means from one معنى الحقيقي to another معنى الحقيقي. So they said it's nuqilat, they were moved, transferred from that old meaning, which was literal, to shar'i meaning. بالوضع تعيني or تعيني, either with a specific designation or with, you know, frequency of usage. حتى صارت حقائق الشرعية في تلك المعاني في عصره. In the same age of Rasulullah, era of Rasulullah. لأن تلك الألفاظ كانت كثيرة التداول بين المسلمين. Because they were very much used by Muslims, especially الصلاة التي يعدونها كل يوم خمس مرات ويسمعونها كرارا من المآذن, from many rites. They used to listen this repeatedly from many rites. ومن البعيد. It's very unlikely أن لا تصبح حقائق في معانيها المستحدثة في وقت ليس بقليل. It's very unlikely that they don't become true usage of these terms shortly after so many times of using them. أما الثاني. But the second opinion is that it didn't happen in the time of Rasulullah. أن سيرورة تلك الألفاظ حقائق شرعية على لسان النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم يتوقف على الوضع. If you want to say they became حقيقي and Rasulullah used by his tongue the same thing, this needs designation. Either تعيني or تعيني. الأول, if you say it's تعيني, it's بعيد جدا. It's very unlikely. If Rasulullah had mentioned that I designate this term for this meaning, we would have received such report. Al-Awwalu ba'idun jiddan wa illa nuqila ilayna. Otherwise it would have been transmitted to us, reported to us. Wa thani ta'ayyuni yatawaqqafu ala kathrat al-istimal allati hiya bihaja ila waqtin tawil. وأين هذه من قصر مدة وقصر مدة عصر النبوة. The life of the prophethood, the age of prophethood was 23 years. And this is not enough for تعيني. But his Ayatollah Subhani says, there is a problem, an objection. يلاحظ عليه, as an objection, أن عصر النبوة استغرق 23 عاما وهي فترة ليست قصيرة. This is not short لحصول الوضع التعيني على لسانه. 23 years is not a short time for reaching the point that it got this meaning. وإنكاره مكابرة. If you don't accept this, it's مكابرة, means you don't want to accept the truth. It's a kind of hesitation to accept the truth. So, some people say it is established in the time of the Prophet, and Ayatollah Subhani seems to prefer this one. because it says 23 years is enough. So at least that's a ta'ayuni in the time of the Prophet. Some people say no, it was after the Prophet.
What does it mean ta'ayuni in English?
Ta'ayuni. Ta'ayun means by itself become mu'ayya, means by itself became a specific. Ta'ayun. Ta'ayun is something that you do it by intention. Ta'ayun. You allocate, you define, you decide, you determine. Ta'ayun means something that happens by itself.
How can someone say that it happened by ta'ayyun after the Prophet, when the Prophet and the Quran used it in that meaning?
So they say then all the cases in the Quran are with Qarīnah. It's because of Qarīnah that we understand it that way. Thamaratul Bahs. What is the outcome, the benefit of this discussion? Thamaratul Bahs. Thamara means fruit. What is the outcome of this discussion? As I told you, what is samara? If a term is used, for example, in the time of Rasulullah, and you don't know whether it is used in man al-Haqīqī or shar'i, lughavi or shar'i, if you don't believe in haqiqat al-shar'iyya, you have to assume that's used in manai lughavi. Amma thamaratul bahs bayna al-qawlayn fadhahara في الألفاظ الواردة على لسان النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم بلا قرينة. This discussion shows its fruits. Means this is the outcome of this discussion. When there are terms which have been used by Rasulullah, they have occurred on the tongue of Rasulullah without evidence. Because if there is evidence that it is used in manner shar'i or lughavi, we don't have any doubt. But there is no evidence, still you have to find the meaning. So we assume that they are used in al-ma'na lughavi if we don't believe in haqiqat shar'iyya. If you believe in haqiqat shar'iyya in the sense that in the time of Rasulullah it got the new meaning, then you don't need to interpreted as ma'na al-lughavi. فَتَظْهَرُ فِي الْأَلْفَاظِ الْوَارِدَةِ عَلَى لِسَانِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ بِلَا قَرِينَةٍ فَتُحْمَلُ عَلَى الْحَقِيقَةِ الشَّرْعِيَّةِ بَنَاءً عَلَى ثُبُوتَهَا. If we accept that حقيقت الشرعية is ثابت, حقيقت الشرعية is true, so we take them to mean المعنى الشرعي, religious sense. وعلى الحقيقة اللغوية, we take it to mean the literal meaning. بناءً على إنكار حقيقة الشرع, إنكارها means إنكار حقيقة الشرع. So if we say that in the time of Rasulullah these religious meanings were not established, so now you have to take it to mean the first meaning. If say the new meanings were established, so you mean the second. But he says, وَالظَّاهِرُ إِنْتِفَاءُ الثَّمَرَةِ مُطْلَقًا. He said, but this seems just to be a theory. There is no really any impact, any benefit for this discussion. Why? لَعَدَمِ الشَّكْ فِي مَعَانِ الْأَلْفَاظِ الْوَارِدَةِ فِي الْكِتَابِ وَالسُّنَّةِ. We don't have doubt about the meaning of the terms which are used in the Quran and Sunnah. لِكَيْ يَتَوَقَّفَ فَهْمُ مَعَانِيهَا عَلَى ثُبُوتِ الْحَقِيقَةِ الشَّرْعِيَّةِ أَوْ نَفِيهَا. We don't have any doubt in the meaning of the terms which are used in the Quran. So not so that we don't have doubt, so that, for example, we say, okay, now to understand their meaning, we need to establish this question. If we believe حَقِيقَةِ الشَّرْعِيَّةِ, we take it to mean the second meaning. If you don't believe, you take it to mean the first meaning. He says, we don't have such doubt. إِلَّا نَادِرًا. Maybe very rarely you find a sentence that you don't know salat is used in the the new sense or old sense? Yes.
But Shaykh, I'm surprised that he says there's no use for it. Because even if it was one instance where we have a doubt, then there still is use for this principle and this idea.
Yes.
Yeah. It removes this one doubt. So I'm a bit surprised he says there's no use for it.
So he doesn't think of any serious case.
Mm.
It seems that there are no serious cases. This is just for the sake of understanding.
Mm.
You know, many discussions in Usul al-Fiqh are relevant to our usage of Fiqh and Usul al-Fiqh, but some of them are not. Some of them are just in order to have a comprehensive discussion. Otherwise, we may never face any problem that we want to solve it by this. But for you, there is samara. You know, these discussions, maybe they don't have samara for mujtahid, but for you, they have samara. What is the samara? First of all, you understand this terminology which may occur in many texts. Secondly, you can sharpen your mind. These are discussions that give you a broad and deep perspective about language. And also, you can pass your exam.
Also,
so
Sheikh,
these are all samara.
Another samara, Sheikh, I see that, you know, in our new days, many people come out and say, oh, see, that or that, you know. So maybe somebody say, no, Allah means in the Quran, salah and dua, and salah is dua, no salah. We shouldn't pray. Somebody would say that. And then we have this as summary of our discussion with these people.
But then that person may not listen to these things. Eh? But yes, right. Well, it is said that once a person wanted to dig a well in his house. So he brought someone and he started digging the earth. And then he said, this is useless. We are not getting to water. So the owner of the house said, if this well doesn't have water for us, it has bread for you. Because you are getting your money. So you can, at least for you it's useful.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you get your salary and you go. So
yeah,
it says,
yeah.
اگر برای ما آب ندارد برای تو نان دارد. So some of these discussions, if they don't have, you know, one benefit, but they have another benefit. Yes.
Why can't we say, for example, that it's actually ma'na haqiqi lughawi, but just an instance, a particular type of instance of the ma'na haqiqi lughawi?
No, because the new meaning is established. It's no longer meant to be dua only or to be imsak only. When you hear salat, you never think about to call. You mean this special ritual prayer?
But it's still within that.
So there was a connection. There is always connection. You know, you don't use a term for a new meaning without any. There must be a similarity, a connection. It must be a type of it. Why salat is used in saying prayer and not in giving alms?
Yes.
There is a connection. Yeah.
But for example, with ayn, sometimes there's no connection between them at all.
In ayn, it's different. Ayn is at the same time.
Yeah.
It's different from transferring from one meaning to a similar meaning. Okay. I just give you a little introduction to the next topic, because I don't want to put lots of things in one session. Unless you say you are okay, then we can carry on. If you are a little bit tired, So at least let me prepare you for next session. The next session would be, inshallah, about a very important discussion. As-sahihu wal-a'am. As-sahihu wal-a'am. Salat, for example, sometimes is valid, sometimes it's void. You accept?
Yes.
Valid means sahih. Void means fasid. No, corrupt. But here we don't say corrupt, we say void or invalid. Okay? Zakat, hajj. Now people may go to hajj, but their hajj is not valid. It's void. It's possible. Is it clear? Or, for example, transaction. So it can be ibadat, it can be mu'amilat. For example, someone buys or sells something, and we say this transaction was valid. Sometimes we say, no, this was not valid. For example, you paid money for something which has no benefit. This is aklul mal bil batil. Yeah? You cannot pay money to buy something which has no reasonable usage. Okay? So, the question is this. Are the terms which are used for ibadat or mu'amilat, for acts of worship or for transactions, are they designated ta'inan or ta'ayunan? In any way, are they designated for sahih only, for valid acts of worship and transactions, or for what is more general? Is valid salat only salat, or even a void salat can be called salat? Is the question. Did you get the point? If someone goes to Hajj and makes, you know, some problems for himself in Hajj, you know, doesn't do some of the, for example, major acts of Hajj, and his Hajj is fasid, is invalid. Can we say he has done Hajj, but Hajj was invalid? Or we should say he has not done Hajj. Yeah? So the question is, are these terms which are used for ibadat or mu'amilat, for acts of worship or for transactions, are they designated for valid acts of worship and transactions only, or for more general, which includes valid and invalid ones? This is discussion. As-sahih wal-a'am. Sahih means only for valid ones. A'am means more general. It can be sahih, it can be fasid. If someone says, for example, one rak'ah prayer, can we say this is salat, but fasid and invalid, or we cannot say this is salat?
Salat al-witr is
one. No, no. I am talking about salat which have to be 2 rak'ah, 4 rak'ah. Or if someone makes salat without wuzu, is this salat or is not salat? So this is the question. Okay? Those who are sahihi, we call them sahihi and a'ammi. Those who are sahih means those whose opinion that it is used only for valid ones, they say if you use it for those which are not valid, it's majazi. Okay? It's not really salah, just we have to say something. We don't have any term, so we say invalid salat. Otherwise, not salat. Those who are a'ammi, they say no, whether salat is valid or not, it's salat. It can be really, truly called salat. Okay? So this is the discussion for, inshallah, next week. I think it's enough maybe for today, and inshallah we can have discussion inshallah next week. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.
اللهم صل على محمد.